and to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, syndicated columnist Mark Shields, New York Times columnist David Brooks. Mark, Scott Brown has finally officially become the 41st Republican senator. How much is it going to matter?
Well, it's going to matter a lot to Republicans because the reason he came in early, he was supposed to come in next week, was that the National Labor Relations Board has been stymied for years now because there's only two members on it. It requires three for a quorum. And it's so it's, this has served very well the purposes of American business who haven't had a worker complaint acted upon. The Senate Labor Committee reported out the nominee, Craig Becker, who's a labor-friendly, labor union-friendly, worker-friendly nominee, and he's going to be voted upon. And Mitch McConnell and the Chamber of Commerce said, Scott, come on down, and down he came. But I can tell you this, it is...
So are there going to be other ramifications?
Well, the ramifications, I think, are apparent already. There's panic in the Democratic ranks. First of all, they lost Massachusetts. And that just makes everybody vulnerable, everybody who's up facing re-election. Secondly, the panic is there's a loss of confidence in the White House political operation, that they didn't see it coming, that they in no way anticipated, and that once it was coming, didn't act upon it. So there's an anxiety, are we all in trouble, vulnerability? I think that's the principal emotion that's dominating the Democratic side.
On the Democratic, but David, there's some who say this is a good thing, because it's going to cause everybody on both sides to kind of get together, because if they don't get together, there isn't going to be any governing.
Right. Yeah. Well, some people say it's a good thing, and some people are spinning you. It's not a good thing. You know, there are some people say, some Democrats who say, well, we never really had 60 votes anyway. This just makes it obvious. So I guess that point is fair enough. But I'm struck by there are sort of like three climactic moods one detected, especially Thursday, yesterday. The Republicans are just excited. The Republicans on the Hill, the prospective House candidates are arriving on the Hill to talk through how they're going to run in November, and they're coming out of the woodwork. Dan Coats in Indiana, who's going to run in the Senate, coming out of the woodwork, a former senator, will challenge Evan Bayh, very good candidate. So the Republicans just feel the wind is at our backs. Let's just keep it going, keep it going. And then on the congressional Democrats, you've got, as Mark described, these degrees of panic. So you had Al Franken from Minnesota attacking David Axelrod this week. You had Blanche Lincoln criticizing President Obama this week for not being liberal or not being conservative or different. And then on the White House side, there I detect sort of an atmosphere of serenity. You know, constancy, just keep on keeping on. They're not really fighting amongst themselves. They're not really changing. They're not going to switch into some Clintonite mode. They're just keeping on. So there are these three different groups.
Does that mean that President Obama and his folks now feel they're kind of off the hook now because they can blame a lot of the Republican no voting on them, obviously, and take the heat off themselves? Is that what's going on here?
That may be part of it. I think a major element in the serenity David describes is the calendar. Every House member is up every 2 years. Mm-hmm. They're all facing the voters' verdict this November. The president has a four-year term and a four-year cycle. I'd remind viewers of President Reagan, who lost 26 seats in his first midterm, then got reelected 2 years later. Bill Clinton lost 53 seats in his midterm, then get reelected. So the serenity is partly induced by the fact that, look, it may be a rough patch right now. We're not on the ballot this November. The other people are.
Right. I also think it's partly that. I think also to their credit, they're not fighting. They're not stabbing each other in the back in the White House. There seems to be still general cohesion. But I also think they don't get it as much as members of Congress do. I think members of Congress are more directly connected mm-hmm. to the electorate. And so the tie that is out there, which I think is a very powerful tie and should never be underestimated, I don't quite think they in the White House understand how unusual a political circumstances we are now in.
Yeah, the coming of Scott Brown has done another thing, which has brought a huge focus to the 41 votes, the supermajority, the 60 votes required to get anything through Congress. Where do you come down on that?
I think as a matter of culture, if we had a culture of bipartisanship, I think the need for 60 votes, the filibuster, would be invoked less frequently. We could go back to that period. And I'd like to see do that. I'm not sure I'd like to see a legislative change totally eliminated. You know, Republicans tried when they were in office, and now a lot of Democrats are talking about it, in part because I do think the 60 votes, A, represents some caution in our government, and two, it forces some level of bipartisanship. And I, in general, over the long haul, I think that's generally healthy, so worth tolerating the inconvenience that the party in power always feels to get that 60 votes.
You have a filibuster position, Mark?
I do, Jim.
Well, what is it?
Vice President Biden, I thought, made a good point when he said losing the, putting as rosy a scenario as he could on the result, that losing the 60th vote was really a sense of relief. I mean, because you were expected to pass things.
That's part
when
of
you
the
had
serenity.
60.
You
a little, it's a little bit of the serenity, but there's a certain reality mm-hmm. in the sense now that there is a responsibility on the other side as well. Because when you have the 60, there's a sense that, well, we can do it. We don't have to pay attention to the other side. And the other side is therefore not only simply ignored, but they're alleviated of it, lifted of any responsibility. I do think, Jim, that I'm not against breaking the 60. I do think we have to return to the concept of constitutional majority, and that's 51 senators. I mean, George Bush would not have passed his tax cuts without using 51 senators. They bypassed the 60. They went directly to voting through what they call a reconciliation. But it was a constitutional majority. Ronald Reagan's tax cuts would not have been passed. The Medicare provisions under George Bush and the pharmaceutical drugs would not have been passed except with 51 votes, 53 votes, by going bypassing the 60. I think it's time for the majority, the 59, to use the Constitution, invoke the constitutional majority, say there are important things that have to be done in this country. I'm sorry, we're not going to stand on the formality of 60. But we saw the spirit of bipartisanship already today when Dick Shelby, Richard Shelby, the Republican senator from Alabama, put a hold on 70 nominees of the administration who are on the executive calendar waiting to be confirmed. Why? Because the air-to-air tanker contract for Mobile, Alabama, has not been held up by the Pentagon. Some people would call that an earmark. But, I mean, that's the spirit of bipartisanship that you're seeing at this point.
David?
Well, that's the nature of the Senate, that one person can
do this.
Can do this. And that's always been the case. And, you know, the Senate is famously, what's the phrase, the saucer where the milk cools? I'm sort of messing that up. But the idea was things rush through and then things cool down in the Senate. And that's what our founders wanted. They wanted a government in which it was extremely difficult to do stuff. And it's become extra difficult because of the polarization. But to me, that it's the polarization that is a problem, not the Constitution. And the polarization has caused us to resort to the 60 much more often than necessary. But unless you actually get the parties actually work together to some degree, the rules will, changing the rules will not help.
Mark, also the Secretary of Defense, Robert Gates, and Admiral Mullen, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, really made news this week with their statement saying it's time to move on from don't ask, don't tell in the military. What do you think of that?
Well, I was really struck by Admiral Mullen's words. He said, as a naval officer since 1968, I have served with gay service members who've served their country well. I've known that. And I've come to the conclusion that this is unacceptable, to exclude people and to isolate them on the basis of their sexual orientation. I think in this case, Jim, people have compared it to race and Harry Truman in 1948. In that case, the president and the military were leading society. I mean, to desegregate a major American institution in 1948 was really rather
and it came
remarkable.
Out of nowhere. He did it
came
on
out
his
of
own.
Nowhere. Yeah. Did it. It was an historic act. Yeah. I think now, and I was just looking this morning, in 1987, the Pew poll asked, do you think a local school board has the right to fire a teacher who's a known homosexual? 51% of Americans said that they thought it did, just on that basis alone. 20 years later, that had dropped to 28%. And it's dropped even more, you can be sure, today, now 3 years later, because it's a generational thing. I think in this case, the military is basically following society and its lead.
You agree with that?
I agree. I support the move. And I also support the way they've done it. And they've done it in a very slow way. It's about we're going to study it, we're going to try to reconcile it. Sure. And sometimes you put something into a study when you don't want to kill it. But I think in this case, for a lot of us who would like to see it done faster, we're not in the military, it would be a mistake to try to impose this from outside onto that institution. I think it's important to let that institution get used to the idea. And I think there's, if there continues to be leadership to the top, you'll get progress without a rejection or a recoil, which would come if you tried to push it too quickly. So I think the way they're doing it is actually quite wise.
Well, what about the idea here? It was President Obama who first mentioned this in a very direct way in his State of the Union address just a few days ago, and now suddenly the Secretary of Defense says, yeah, that's fine, and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs says, okay, yes, and the Republicans are saying, oh, they're just being ordered to do this by the president.
Well, I don't think Gates and Mullen would necessarily be ordered. Colin Powell in his day, he's now changed his mind, but in his day he said, no, I'm not ready for this. And so I suspect there are a lot of people, especially at the top element of the military, who have shifted. And I suspect a lot of people in privates have shifted, just as society has shifted. Nonetheless, I do think the pace they're going at, while very slow, is correct.
Of course, General
Jim Jones, sir, the former commandant of the Marine Corps and national security advisor of the president, cautioned him last year not to do it in a hurry, to take the time. And Admiral Mullen was very frank. He said he spent the last year figuring out how to do it, how to deal with the problems. This didn't come as a surprise to him. He had come to this this conviction himself.
One of the most outspoken Republican senators about this, and criticizing Gates and Mullen to his face, of course, was Senator John McCain. How do you read what's going on with John McCain right now?
There's two things at work. First of all, when anybody runs for president, there's a burst of pride in the home state voters. And when that candidate loses, as most candidates for president do, the vote...
50% of them usually do.
Like 95% do. But the turn, and they say, we gave you a hell of a job as a United States Senator. What are you doing running for president? So McCain has got that going against him in Arizona. But in addition to that, he has problems. He's being challenged on his right by J.D. Hayworth, a former Republican conservative congressman from the state, anti-immigration, or harsh on immigration, however you want to put it, going after McCain, going after McCain as well on his opposition to George Bush's tax cuts in the previous administration. So John McCain, and the thing that really surprised me the most was he was a supporter of the Greg Conrad Budget Commission to bring down the deficit, which required the members to consider openly both tax cuts and entitlement cuts. I mean, it was the tough tonic. He was a sponsor of it, and he ended up voting against it. And the only explanation that even people who love John McCain can give at this point is that the fear of being considered soft on tax increases, it was made him vulnerable in the primary, and I think for that reason he deserted a position he'd held.
There's definitely been a series of shifts, that, campaign finance, global warming, the gays in the military. And there's that element, and I can't psychoanalyze McCain. I think there's also a great deal of anger at the military, at the media, where he was a darling and felt was disloyal to him in the campaign. Great deal of anger at President Obama, who he thinks is a bad president. And so I think there's a lot else going on that has to do with running for president, losing, that has shifted him in a more conservative direction, whether it's an intellectual shift, an emotional shift, or a political shift caused by J.D. Hayworth. All those things probably play some role in what has been a shift to the right for John McCain.
Does it seem to you to be a little more angry than he has been in the past?
I would say when he came back after he'd won, he was energized. And if you remember the stimulus debate, he was very outspoken on that. He's been very outspoken in the Senate. But I guess among fellow senators, they would say he's become angrier. No one loses a presidential election and is unaffected by it. Everyone is affected by it in some way.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Both of you.